The following are some general observations about INFPs that I've made. It's meant as almost like a sort of counter-stereotype, but this is not the main functional description in any way. These are just some observations that might help to solidify the image that I'm trying to paint here from at least my experience with INFPs. For one, they always seem to be gentle, kind, and unobtrusive. Those are sort of some of the main words I would use, and I don't mean gentle in a not strong kind of way, but that's just one of the things that seems to come off of them. They often seem a bit maladjusted to the world around them, also not in a bad way, often in a charming way. There's something that seems ever so slightly off about them, sort of odd or eccentric, or just these traits that they'll have that vary very much across INFPs, but which seem to clearly arise from their reclusive tendency or a reclusive tendency in thought or even in their habitation. They are a bit like fairy or fae, and that's a very poetic image. But in my opinion, they sort of embody this contradiction between otherworldly fragility and this otherworldly resolution that if you're familiar with old-style fairy stories, you'll be very familiar with of them being very frail, but also you don't want to mess with them. INFPs are fascinated by individuals' inner values and ways of working. They love to watch and understand people. This is why they are so aware of and adamant about individuality. They don't like the idea of extroverted thinking repressing introverted feeling, and we're going to get into that a lot in this video. They are terrified of the idea of losing one's individual values to some system or intellectual system. They hate it when people's individuality and inner light are squashed in any way. They are impressionable. They base a great deal on past experiences and feelings. This is an idea there. Their SI serves as a wealth of experience for them, and we'll get into that more. There is a sense of cleverness and trickiness to them, or that can be there. They have less compunction about making harmless jests and taking on personas for fun, for harmless reasons. Overall, there is a sense that they are like a forest fae, that's my poetic image, clever, fragile, yet resolute, fickle, and preferring to follow their heart and desire, individualistic, alien, foreign, curious, and odd, despising the threat of man's encroaching technology and so-called advancement, and the resulting imposition on their spirit and soul by inhumanity. Now, in general, and as already sketched in the ISTJ video, the TEFI axis functions as follows. Extroverted thinking forms judgments based on facts and data gleaned from their experience of objects, forming general rules, laws, and principles grounded in what they deem externally self-evident. Introverted feeling contrastingly forms judgments based on sentiments, values, desires, intensities, and/or feeling tones constellated in the subject. This forms its own kinds of rules, laws, and principles, but grounds them in what is so internally intense it cannot be ignored, what is subjectively self-evident, if you will. Either one or the other, extroverted thinking or introverted feeling, might start off the process, assuming there technically is a start, but the dynamic is always between what is subjectively desired by the subject and what is objectively demanded by the facts of the situation. Your feelings versus the facts, if you want to put it crudely. As expressed in my Judgment Axes video, this dynamic can be roughly summarized by the statement, what do you want, FI, and how can we get it, TE. The INFP, being FI dominant, is primarily conscious of the first half of this statement, what do you want? Of course, for them the question is far, far more nuanced than just some simple desire. I have heard INFPs describe introverted feeling as a tumult of emotions, many of them at once and in various shades and intensities, buzzing, humming, soaring, roaring, diving, and then buried in mud, as Virginia Woolf wrote. The FI dominant is thus a connoisseur of emotional states and sentiments. They don't just know, say, anger, but 100 or so different degrees and shades of anger and its mixtures with other emotions, as well as the complex instigations and inner workings of these kinds of anger. If the preoccupation of one's consciousness is the question, what does your subject desire, you can bet they'll be quite the experts on feeling states and the various ways in which they desire things. For instance, the soliloquies of William Shakespeare, the hierarchy of loves described by St. Augustine, and the diapsalmata from Soren Kierkegaard's work Either Or. This is the most prominent feature of the INFP personality, their personal experience of feeling tones. They explore in a far more nuanced way than any other type what precisely they want and desire, and are in the best position then, out of all of the types, to understand with the greatest nuance what others at bottom desire as well. INFPs have pointed out to me that just as with INFJs, other types, just because they are having subjective experiences doesn't mean that they don't get insight because of the universal human experience, if you want to put it that way. INFPs are very knowledgeable about what other people are feeling and are in a unique position of insight there, which lends to what Leon of Type Tips has described as the INFP's counseling capacity, particularly towards INFJs in his opinion. As they are so experienced with human feeling, INFPs are so experienced with human feeling and can thus distinguish and apprehend the sentimental principles of others' desires with the same categorizing clarity of introverted thinking, as opposed to the more reactive extroverted feeling. Further, like introverted thinking types, the INFP's constant experience of the tumbling feeling tones results in their developing very intense principles, which represent their organization, categorization, and prioritizing of the world around them. These judgments are naturally experienced as peculiar to the INFP's subject, just as with, say, an INTP, and thus at some degree of variance with the values and judgments made by society at large. Yet, even if the INFP finds themselves in agreement with the rest of society, it is still suffocating for them to conform or harmonize simply for the sake of harmony. The idea of losing oneself, one's identity, to the homogeneity of the mob is terrifying. Hence the phrase, don't lose yourself, be true to yourself, etc. To them, not differentiating or individuating themselves, that is, realizing their values despite whatever the crowd has to say about it, in favor or out of favor, it's equal to, say, the introverted intuitive type never realizing their visions and insights in the world because people refuse to listen to them, or the introverted thinking type being unable to think and question for themselves because of interfering authority, or the introverted sensation type being shunned or marginalized for living according to their wisdom rather than the next social phenomenon. Of all these cases, the INFP experiences the oppression of their values with the greatest intensity, precisely because it is intensities and feelings themselves that are being oppressed. In my original INFP video, I described their inner realm as a series of caverns that the INFP explores, seeking after a mysterious light burning in the deepest depth of the caverns and illuminating them all with various glows. Meanwhile, the INFP discovers in each cavern fantastic and delightful natural structures as well as ancient treasures and troves from strange unknown cultures. Now, I hold by that metaphor as a useful way to depict the way INFPs often feel, and would like to add that to harmonize with society is like completely ignoring these caverns or even dumping the jewels and artifacts into the ocean so as to please other people. To the INFP, as I understand it, wouldn't it be far better for oneself and others to sacrifice some harmony in exchange for showing others the beautiful light hidden within each other? And what if perchance another person showed similar artifacts, similar values or loves, and now both people can delight in each other's genuine work? It is extremely important to note, however, that it is not, as I've implied before, so much a resistance of extroverted feeling shown here as a resistance to extroverted thinking. The INFP shouldn't be thought of as struggling with being warm and kind and comforting. Anyone who's met an INFP knows full well that that is not the case. Their independence isn't at the direct expense of others' comfort. Rather, it is often at the direct expense of perhaps the facts of the situation represented by extroverted thinking. The INFP regards their subjective desires as more real and important than any external structure or law imposed on them, expecting them to obey regardless of their conscience, their values, or whether they like it or not. This is a key. It is not so much a matter of disliking harmonizing itself as it is the fear of not realizing one's individual passions. It is not so much about what is being demanded as how it is being demanded. To put it simply, the INFP prefers that obedience be their idea, or at least partially their idea. They want to do it because they want to do it, and not because it's merely said to be right or said to be moral. They want to know very much for themselves whether it is moral or right, and if they disagree with you, they will greatly resent being pressed to contradict themselves. If they must grow themselves into a certain shape, they want to do so entirely of their own volition and not by means of someone's cookie cutter imposing on them and severing parts of themselves in order to fit them into a mold. Of course, as a result, the INFP is loath to ever so impose on others as well. Especially when dealing with individuals, the INFP is very often warm and genuine and unimposing, letting other people just be. This does not contradict their sense of strong values, however, for the INFP will still express themselves and argue for themselves and defend themselves and so forth, but they won't impose on others, and certainly won't propose that others simply give up what they want in favor of what the INFP wants, much less because of some fact or plainly observable principle in nature. What they want is mutual freedom to express values. In fact, INFPs will often encourage people to really express who they are, to really say, what are you feeling right now? They don't want anyone to hold back their true feelings or true nature because they feel that the INFP is somehow imposing on them in some way. I can tell you for a fact, they don't like that. Generally, they have a great deal of optimism about people's underlying desire, believing people to be genuinely good, if they would just be themselves rather than what society tells them to be. This lends to the INFP's famous capacity for listening, particularly as described by Leon of Type Tips in conjunction with the neural research of Dario Nardi. INFPs are, either way, great listeners precisely because they don't impose in any way on what another person is saying. They want the person to feel free to be themselves rather than hold back important elements of themselves. They always want to help others grow themselves, never sculpt them. And this requires open listening to what is in the speaker, what they desire, what germs or seeds are seeking for nourishing sunlight from within them. In my ISTJ video, I described the NESI dynamic as, very generally, one of chaos and order, where SI is rooted, stable, and consistent by nature, and NE is uprooted, unstable, and inconsistent. NE is an explorer, a reporter, a tumbleweed, a migrating bird. These things are necessarily uprooted so as to gather in as much information as possible. The watchwords here are creativity, novelty, innovation, and possibility. And while these are shadows in the ISTJ, they are consciously exercised and clearly present in the INFP. The INFP then has a distinct exploratory side to them, which assists the already independent and idiosyncratic function introverted feeling. It is now easy to see why the INFP seems so alien or unusual. Their conscious personality is a pair of generally idiosyncratic and boundary-pushing functions. It is primarily this NE boundary-pushing that distinguishes INFPs from ISFPs. Where the ISFP is more directly sensual in their tastes, the INFP is more eclectic and helter-skelter, or at least tends to be. They take an interest here and here and over here, and they catch sight of possibilities like a husbandman finding and plucking the ripest berries for later. And where the ISFP's relationship with the future is more contemplative, mystical, and synthetic, the INFP's relationship to the future is more lively, energized, immediately observant, clever, and most of all, disparate. That is, it's not synthetic. The ISFP perceives a comprehensive, consistent, encompassing vision. The INFP perceives a shattered mirror of possibilities, each shard reflecting a new angle of things. In general, the work of ISFPs will have a rather more consistent underlying theme and tone that are difficult to express or cognate, but are always weaving in and out ethereal in the background. INFPs, on the other hand, tend to appear much more versatile and broad in their tones and themes, isolating and exploring each one individually. For example, take the musical work of Enya Brennan versus that of Regina Spektor. both rather shy and gentle, introverted feeling heavy individuals, but in my estimation, Enya, who's the ISFP, her songs all retain an underlying current of mysticism that is above all difficult to describe, unless you've heard the music. Meanwhile, Regina Spektor's work is much more eclectic in subject matter and mood, with each song representing its own mirror shard insight, albeit it's all from the same mirror. INFPs have a certain susceptibility to boredom, just as INTPs do, and thus too much consistency, too much of the same underlying theme or routine, it's stifling to them. They need creative space and freedom to explore, to experiment with new perspectives and new styles, which naturally leads to iconoclasm and clashes with authority that threatens to restrain their self-expression. Impositions on the INFP's introverted feeling values is bad enough, but combine that with a repression of their NE curiosity, and what you have is the INFP nightmare, a society of obedient, unquestioning, identical, robotic, cookie-cutter zombies, strongly reminiscent of Orwell's 1984. Nevertheless, the idea of consistency and anchoring is not itself repugnant to the INFP as it is represented by a distorted ISTJ shadow, and that's what I'm going to get into next. Introverted sensation is the more clearly visible shadow in the INFP personality, which is why I relate them closer to the ISTJ than the ESTJ. For all their fundamental and often artistic iconoclasm, the INFP is first concerned with their values, and only second with exploration, meaning that the INFP does accept, more so than the ENFP, conscious manifestations of their underlying introverted sensation processes, namely, the internal perceptions, ideal forms, and concretized traditions described in the ISTJ video, if you want to check that out. Introverted sensation is all about solidifying and synthesizing perceptions, rather than constantly collecting new ones. So, to put it poetically, one could imagine that the INFP is sometimes exhausted by their auxiliary NE, which insists that they go from here to here to here without any rest, and the INFP, to protect themselves, resort to certain SI capitulations. A fuller degree of experimentation or exploration is sacrificed to the relative certainty of introverted sensation and its concretized ideals. The INFP more willingly settles in kinds of truth than the ENFP or ENTP. By that I mean the INFP more willingly accepts a set, concretized perception of things. The INFP is thus more grounded and anchored than the ENFP, more willing to be at home and to relegate their extroverted intuition to more intellectual or fantastical exploration rather than any physical actual travel. In any case, regardless of how developed the INFP is, there will always be that same naive fascination and striving for the tertiary function, which in the INFP's case is introverted sensation. Just as the ISTJ fears they are too focused on getting things done and not on what they themselves desire, the INFP fears, at times, that they are too focused on chasing quickly wilting dreams rather than settling into and savoring life one quiet day at a time. Maybe I'm going too fast, the INFP wonders. Maybe I'm too caught up in cool new things and I need to get back in touch with the past, with some kind of grounding or with some kind of tradition. An excellent example of this is provided in Soren Kierkegaard's book Either Or, which can be interpreted as his own self-examination and dissection of his conscious INFP personality, which is represented by the character A, and his unconscious ISTJ personality, represented by the character Judge William. An analysis of the work would take too long for this video, so suffice it to say that Judge William is a caricatured ISTJ. That's basically what he is. And the one lying inside the INFP and simultaneously scorned and longed after by Kierkegaard. A rigid, upstanding, somewhat uninterested, but certainly admirable, kind of stodgy, self-satisfied, but a defender of traditional values. It is this defense of tradition and fascination with the detailed image of a grounded, simply living person, a homely person with a stable family and all of that, which mainly composes their tertiary introverted sensation. Some other examples might be Tolkien's Hobbits and their homely life, Blake's Song of Innocence, Rousseau's Noble Savage, Milne's Winnie the Pooh. finally, a brief discussion of inferior extroverted thinking in the INFP. While unimposing, they strive to be, with their focus happily on expression of feelings rather than on the accomplishment of them. It should not be thought that INFPs are generally unaware of their difficulty in accomplishing things efficiently and of some of their own silliness. On the contrary, INFPs can be just as cleverly self-depreciating as INTPs, and especially of their TEFI axis. Bill Watterson, for instance, who during legal battles over the commercialization of his comic strip, made a number of comics mocking his own stubborn FI principles. And as another example, A.A. Milne, who said, quote, "Sarcasm directed into the blue in the hope of hitting the person you want may not be effective, but it does relieve the feelings." What is of particular interest for us, however, is the manner that TE is nevertheless expressed, for the INFP is all too aware that they lack it and may begin expressing consciously or unconsciously certain capitulations or reconciliations with extroverted thinking as they perceive it. It's been remarked by fellow enthusiasts as well as contributors to CelebrityTypes.com that the inferior function has a very black and white nature to it. I agree with this idea and find it particularly evident in the INFP, whose attempts to express extroverted thinking effectiveness are overtly blunt, without any consideration at all for feeling tones, but for getting the thing done that is desired. The INFP, when capitulating to extroverted thinking, at least as I've seen it, whether in theory or in practice, isolates a logical goal and strides towards it with exaggerated forcefulness, as though they're trying to compensate for their perceived lack of extroverted thinking. For instance, what I'm referring to here from my experience is an INFP friend of mine, with exaggerated brusqueness, defended a reserved seat while we were in the movie theater. He was really quite pushy there. Another, already under a great deal of work stress, found error with everything I did. That was a fun time for me. Even when he had done similar things on other occasions and sought rather forcefully, yet ineffectively, to correct me. Now, last time, in my last video, I introduced the idea of a sort of like a familiarity map in which I mapped out how familiar a particular type was likely to be with another type due to their functions. I'm going to do that again here. I'm not going to read it out to you guys because I think it's a little boring, but you can see the chart right here, and you're probably most interested in what I consider to be the quote-unquote most opposite type. But just so I reiterate, because there's been some controversy about it, it's not a compatibility chart. It's not telling you how well you're going to necessarily get along. It can make indications of that. It was more of an attempt to try to map out from a certain perspective. Thank you for watching this video. Sorry it took so long, and I do love making these videos. I mean, I'm very, very glad that I was able to get around to making this. So thank you so much for the support. I hope that you enjoy this. Please let me know what you think in the comments below, and I will see you in the next video. Thank you.